said that he will call Nitish and get back.
I had a word with him, sir. So I think we can start now. We can start now.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Hello and welcome to Legally Speaking with me, Tarun Nangia. The topic that is going to be talked about today is very interesting. It is the insight into virtual courts post the corona crisis. So far as what we have seen, that this has become the greatest enabler. This crisis has emerged as a greatest enabler towards digitization and adoption of digital methods in the court system, as well as the overall legal universe within this country. To throw more light on this issue, we have eminent guests with us today. Justice Sanjeev Sachdeva, Judge Delhi High Court. He is our chief guest and speaker today. We also have senior advocate Priya Hingorani with us, who's also going to speak after him. We have advocate Joseph Aristotle, Secretary Scora. He is also going to speak today, as also advocate Amar Sareen and advocate Rubinder Ghuman. So the format of the show is that first, Justice Sachdeva, in about 20-25 minutes, will share a presentation that he has made for us and all of us. He's going to share that with us, following which we'll have senior advocate Priya Hingorani making her points. And then we have other panelists who are going to speak, and then over to the questions that a lot of viewers of today's show want to ask. So may I request Justice Sanjeev Sachdeva to address the audience, please.
Thank you, Tarun. I'm going to share a little bit of presentation with all of you. I'm not going to talk on the legal aspects of the virtual courts. Rather, my presentation is going to be on the practical aspects of the virtual court. We are talking of access to justice, insight into virtual courts post-COVID 2019. Like Tarun just said, COVID-19 has been actually a boon. In the presentation, I'm also going to talk a little bit on what I had said as things to come as late as in the mid of 2019 and where we are today. This is a reminder of some things which we all have seen in the past. I don't know, when I started practice, it was something like this that we had. We had these kind of typewriters, and you would have those 1+3 carbon papers to be used. I don't know, some of the kids don't even know what a carbon paper today looks like. And this is what a printout used to be from a Remington typewriter. And we have actually now to transform the court, something from this is our regular court system that we have, into something like this, where there are no paper, no files, and this is a court scene. In fact, it's been taken from a movie because cameras are not allowed in the courts. So this is something like a court scene which we see day in, day out in the district courts. And we have to actually transform that to this.
Justice Sachdeva, you're not audible. There's a message in the chat saying that you're not quite audible. Could you just speak?
Okay. So we have to transform from what we saw to something like this. Now, an empowered judge would be in a position to dispense justice and effective, speedy justice. Now, we have seen paperless courts in Delhi High Court. This is what a paperless court looks like. This is an e-court system that we have in the High Court, where we had developed for a paperless court for the advocates, an e-system for the advocates, where they can come in with nothing in their hand and argue a case. Now, digitization of record would not only free up space, but also make retrieval of archived data very easy. Technology that we are using, I'm going to talk in this session about technology rather than law, because several questions come to mind from lawyers. Is it easy? Is it tough to transform from a paper file to actually a virtual file? My answer to them is, please change your mindset. It's not tough at all. Technology is there to make things easy for us and not make it tougher. Technology can be molded to give you everything what you actually want in the fashion that you use it in. Now, the hardware that we use in the e-courts is a 21, 27, and 32-inch Wacom touchscreen monitor, which has a digital pen. It's something like this. You can write on this. You can scribble, do whatever you want to. This is exactly this is the photograph of a courtroom that we have, where we have these two Wacoms. This is the scene of a division bench. Now, question arises, what is the digital file? Because lawyers who don't use digital files, they wonder sometimes, what is it that the court or what is it that the judges are using in the form of a digital file? We store your court files in the form of in PDF format. PDF format we all are familiar with, because over WhatsApp, over social media, we're all sharing documents in PDF format. Now, the case files are maintained in portfolios, because what happens in a real file, you have different files in different folders. For example, you have a different folder for pleadings, you have a different folder for order sheets, you have different folder for applications. Now, in a digital file, question arises, is it possible to have different folders? Or everything is in one big bundle that you have to search through? Well, the files that can be maintained in portfolios representing each separate file folders. Now, the issue which arises substantially is, can we create a PDF file? If we can, how can we create it? Is it going to be very expensive? Is it going to be very difficult? Well, let me tell you, in Supreme Court, it's very, very easy. Because in Supreme Court, everything is typed. You don't file photocopies. You'd file typed copies of all documents, pleadings. So you can create a PDF file from a Word document. Your steno types a Word document. All he needs to do is one command and it gets converted into a PDF. Now, supposing you have to file photographs or documents of which photocopies have to be filed. Well, you can create a PDF by scanning those documents. Now, one simple option is, like, this is a Word document, you're typing on Word, all you need to do is go to File and press Save As. And then you can save it as an Adobe document. It's a PDF document. Now, that document can be used by you and uploaded. Now, this is for Word 2007. Word 2010 and 2013 have a concept called File, Share, and Create PDF. And a PDF file is created. Now, in case none of this is available, then you can download it from Microsoft.com. There are links provided. In my presentation, there will be several options which I'll be giving, which will have links. Now, this presentation will be available. The host will place it later on the website, and you'll be able to access these. So you don't need to bother about actually copying these URLs or these locations, because all this will be available. In Mac, you have an export PDF option. Now, in the latest version of Word, you just go to Save As and save it as a PDF document. That's an option you have, and you save it as a PDF document and your PDF is created. Or go to Print and print. You can print to a PDF printer. That also creates a PDF document. So your Word document immediately gets converted into PDF in the click of a button. You don't have to go into scanning. You don't have to pay for scanning. You have to do nothing. Instead of a print command, just store it as PDF. Copy it on a pen drive and you're ready to file it in court. Now, there are also OpenOffice available. You can download OpenOffice. It's a free software. It is compatible with Word. Now, in that also, you can go to export as PDF and save it as a PDF document. So it's that easy to create a PDF document. It's nothing difficult. Well, that is if you're typing it. If it's not being typed, if it's photocopy, if you have to say, or there are certain free websites available which can convert into PDF. Now, if you have to scan a document, all scanners, especially these all-in-one printers that are now available in the market, they provide you with a software whereby you can scan a document and save it as a PDF document. So that software is also available. So you don't have to spend a lot of money in actually buying a PDF software, conversion software. Free softwares are available. Your free option is there in Word. Now, Delhi High Court is also providing an in-house facility for scanning documents. You can take your paper file, pay the specified charges, and the agency will scan the file and give it to you in the required PDF format. Now, during this lockdown period, we are providing free scanning facility at the designated e-filing counters in Delhi courts. In all the district courts, there are e-filing counters where this free scanning facility is being provided. So just take your paper file, they'll scan it for you and upload it for you. Of course, you will need digital signatures, but at the moment, especially in Delhi High Court, we are liberal with digital signatures, but once the lockdown opens, please obtain a digital signature. It's not very difficult, not very expensive. You can then sign the document digitally rather than taking a printout, signing it physically and then uploading it. So this further shortens the file size because every court provides for a limited file size that you can upload. So if you convert a document from Word into PDF, the file size is smaller. But if you scan it, it's slightly bigger. So it's always better to save a Word document as a PDF, digitally sign it and upload. Now, in view of the prevailing lockdown, in the High Court, you have to submit an application with a prayer for exemption from filing duly affirmed affidavit and exemption from paying court fees. Now, as a general rule, the High Court has ruled that within 72 hours of the normal court functioning being resumed, you will be required to file an attested affidavit and the court fees, even if the matter already stands disposed of. So we are trying to, well, the courts are trying to make things easy even during this lockdown period. But yes, there are difficulties we are facing. Now, question is, what about court fees? What happens post lockdown opening? Would we need to buy court fees? Would we need to buy physical court fees? Or do we have e-court fees? Then electronic filing. Well, e-court fees can be purchased from the Stockholding Corporation of India website. It's online. There are counters available in all courts where you can go and purchase your court fees. Or you can straight away go onto their website 24/7, use your mobile wallet, credit card, and you can buy the court fees. This is what the e-court fees looks like. And what is most important is this 16-digit number. This is going to be required in a later part of the presentation when we deal with e-filing. This would be a key number which will be required because this is only a printout of a e-court fees, but you don't need this printout. What you need is only the 16-digit number. Now, mentioning of urgent matters for urgent listing, this is the link where you can mention urgent matters before the registrar, and it's available from 10:30 to 12 noon on all working days. Then you have to explain the urgency by uploading a PDF file comprising of one page note. And if urgent mentioning is declined by the registrar, then you have an option of putting the request up to the designated judge. And this option is available on the same day till 3 p.m. So if there is an urgency, registrar does not agree, well, you can go to the court. The court will consider it. And if allowed, matter will be listed. Now, a new link has been created in the High Court, which has been operational now, which has just been made operational yesterday, with regard to non-urgent ordinary filing. So now in the Delhi High Court, your filing has commenced. You don't need to file only urgent matters. You can file ordinary matters. You can even file pleadings in pending matters. You wish to file something, but word of caution, all this will be scrutinized after the lockdown opens. And then objections will be raised, but facility is made available so that you can make your online non-urgent filing. Now, designated counters of e-filing have been made in the High Court. It's been set up in every district court complex. So you can go to that complex, file it, and during lockdown, like I said, scanning facility has been made available free of cost. So you don't need to travel to the High Court to file. You can go to any one of the court complexes and file from there. And this facility is going to be there now forever. So if anybody wants to file an appeal from a district court, he doesn't come to High Court to file it. He can file it from his own district court without traveling to the High Court. Now, these are steps which High Court has come up with, which will make things far easier for the advocates because it used to take a lot of time traveling from, say, Karkaduma to High Court, Dwarka to High Court, filing a matter, then going back. But here, all you need to do is just on a click of a button, file it sitting in your court itself. Online filing. Well, work is in progress for online filing for the Delhi High Court through a link which will be provided on the High Court website. There are certain security audits. We are going through all that very soon. You never know. Very soon could be actually very, very soon. that you'll be able to do your online filing from the convenience of your own office rather than going to even a district court complex for filing. And this will be available 24/7, of course, subject to the rules with regard to limitation. Now, question is, how do you file a case? It's easier said, all right, you made a PDF. Now, how do I file it? Security purposes, you have to register before filing. It's a one-time registration. Advocates need to provide their bar counsel enrollment number. Parties in person can also register. Law firms can also register. But provided one of their partners or one of their advocates is registered using his bar counsel enrollment number, so a law firm can also register and start filing. One thing is that you have to provide your mobile number and an email address, because a lot of things happen on the email. Once you file, there'll be an account created where you'll be able to view all cases that you have filed, all objections which are raised will be mailed to you over email. They will be available on the desktop for you if you want to see how many cases you filed, how many cases have been cleared, how many cases have been scrutinized, case status, etc. Everything will be available over email. So that's why email is very necessary. Now, these are certain practice directions on email. Now, detailed procedure for registration and e-filing has also been mentioned. These are PDF document links are here. You can always see them later, but these are also available on the High Court website. So you can go to the Delhi High Court website and look at these practice directions and detailed procedure for registration and e-filing. Now, one of the most important things and very necessary thing that the Delhi High Court has done is that when you file a matter, the caveat is normally verified. Now, for verification of a caveat, the memo of parties is required. Now, if you go to a filing counter and type in the memo of parties, it'll take a lot of time. So what High Court has done is it's provided a Excel template where in the template, if you feed in while you're typing your memo of parties for the case, you just feed in the details in the Excel sheet. And when you file, the system automatically picks up the details of all the parties from the Excel sheet and you don't have to type it again. And then you also have to enter that 16-digit code, which I had mentioned about the court fees, and simply upload the file. I'm going to show you a small video on the filing process, and you'll actually see how long or short is the time for filing. Now here, person has come in for a main case filing. Now he's looking at that, he's searching for his Excel template. Now, this is the memo of parties, he's typed in an Excel sheet. Moment he uploads, the entire sheet gets uploaded. He doesn't have to type anything else. He selects the case type, the case category. Then this is that 16-digit code for the court fees. He adds it and immediately the system picks up the court fees number and amount to court fees. Then he looks at the PDF that has been created, confirms and uploads the document. This is exactly the time that is required for an e-filing. You don't have to stand in queues. You don't have to do anything. In seconds, you upload a document, you get your diary number, and an email message is also sent to you immediately that your document has been filed. So it shortens your time. So rather than going, standing in your queue, doing it. Now, if objections are mailed to you, you will also remove the objection in the in your office and upload the file again in the same format. Now, this is an example of what a portfolio looks like. Because we talked of PDF files being converted into portfolios. If you see, we have the orders folder, we have the pleadings folder, the office notings, paper book, these are written submissions. This is a portfolio of a writ petition. Similarly, portfolio and appeal also has the records of the trial court. So this is what a judge would have, or once the file is there with you, you would have for arguing a matter. There's the portfolio of a suit record. The additional is the documents, the depositions. Because in a suit record, there is evidence of witnesses, so deposition comes in a separate folder. Now, once you open the file, now, this is what a e-court cause list looks like. This is just an example to you. This is what the cause list looks like when we run a court, when we open it on the VACOM screen, this is what the cause list looks like. Now, these red markings are actually the personal notes which a judge creates when he's studying the file, or maybe his staff can create, for example, the applications, what are these applications for, and a brief note on the matter. So this can be created, and side by side, this is the portfolio of this writ petition. Now, once opened, the portfolio looks like this. You have the file, this is the index. These are bookmark index on the side. Now that's very important because you always need an index. Now by clicking on the bookmark, you can jump to the relevant document on the file. It'll immediately take you to that particular document. Now we take notes on one note. Now when we are taking notes, we don't take notes on paper. These are notes which you can take on a digital file. The benefit of a note is that it will be there with you for all times to come. You don't have to, you may never forget. You pick up a matter after 6 months, 1 year, your notes are still there in digital format, and these are there for all times to come. Now, this is how you can write on the note. You can highlight the, because sometimes question arises, look, I need to highlight my work. I need to underline it. I need to make a note. I need to put a flag. But you can highlight your note. You can highlight the file. You can underline the file. You can even make a note on the file. And these are available. These will get saved. Now, by clicking on the comment list, because once you highlight, mark, or underline something, a comment list is created on that file. Now, you want to turn immediately to that particular page. So you click on the comment list and it will jump straight to that note and that page. You can, from that document, copy a clipping. You can even copy text. Supposing you want to type something from a judgment, just copy it. It will take it in the Word format. So your steno, you don't have to actually retype it. Just copy it. It'll the text will be there and you can use it as a Word document. And you can simultaneously open two pages of the same file for comparison. This is a telepresence hearing before the COVID happened. This was last year, I think, August of last year, that we had a telepresence hearing on one of the criminal matters. Now, this is what a telepresence hearing used to look like. But this is actually a virtual court hearing which was conducted in one of these lockdown sessions. So you see all the lawyers are connected. We even have some senior advocates connected. The court staff hosted this hearing from his house. The steno was connected also over VC. And the entire thing happened through VC. Nobody had to travel out of their locations to court. Now, hearing is being conducted in Delhi High Court over Cisco WebEx meetings. Supreme Court is using video. Some other high courts are using Zoom and other platforms. Now, at the time of filing, now what is the procedure of a hearing? That's a question which also arises at times. So when you file a matter, you have to provide the email address and the mobile number, also the email address and the mobile number of the opposite party and the advocates. Time slot is allocated for the hearing as per the cause list. Contact details of the courtmaster are shared in the cause list. And the moment a time slot is allotted, a link is sent over email to the email addresses provided. Simultaneous link will go to both the sites and whatever email addresses have been provided. Now, sometimes question arises, look, I've engaged a senior counsel. I want his email address to be added. Or maybe the party wants to join in. So if more participants like parties, advocates, senior advocates, or even officers of the department are to be added, the courtmaster is informed and he will send in additional invites. Now, even during hearing, further participants can be added. So it's a very simple process. By click of a button, an invite can be sent and participants can be added. This is the kind of a email that you will receive. This has the case number and also the date and time when the meeting is scheduled. For each case, there's a separate allocated time allotted and separate allocated link. So you'll have to follow that time. And all you need to do is click on this join meeting button. This is a template of a Cisco WebEx Zoom, we've all seen, we've all connected through Zoom for this session. So on Cisco Webex, you just need to click on this join meeting and you simply are admitted into the meeting. Now, if you want to join through a VC system, the meeting number and the password is also shared. You can connect through a mobile phone, a tablet, a laptop, a desktop, a VC system. Anything which has an internet connection, you can connect through it and join the meeting. Now, when you click on that for the first time, you are required to install the Cisco Webex meeting app. Now, it's an all-in-one install. You don't have to do anything much. Now, somebody may feel, look, I don't want to install Cisco Webex. So you can join directly from your browser. You don't need to install the app. Just join from your browser and you're good to go. Replies, counter affidavits are sent to the designated email address or filed through the designated e-filing link. Even during hearing, if an advocate wants to show a document, you can show a document, you can even email it to the host or the courtmaster, who will then share it with the judge. Now, this is sharing of a document during hearing, like the PowerPoint I'm sharing. It's something very similar to that. So if during hearing you want to show a document to the court or to the other side, or even for recording evidence, you want to show it to a witness, just share it over the screen and the witness sees the document and the hearing can continue. But one thing has to be there, discipline has to be strictly maintained. First and foremost, microphones have to be muted by all except the advocate who's addressing the court. Because if you don't do that, the voice echoes, the hearing time is lost. Then timelines have to be strictly followed. Because what happens is, it's not like an open court that anybody can view what is happening. So someone who's waiting in line next for his matter at the designated time slot, he'll be waiting, not knowing what is happening. Though the courtmaster is on touch with them over the phone, but it's better to maintain discipline. Now, if your matter requires slightly larger time, you can inform the courtmaster that instead of a half an hour slot, we'll probably need a 1 hour slot. So it can be factored into and the hearing can be accordingly scheduled. Now, way forward. Now, this is not which is there, but we can consider this. Give a 10-15 minute audio-video electronic submission in addition to or in place of a written submission. Now, do a video of you arguing a matter in front of your camera. Make that into a clip. Send it to the courtmasters. Upload it with the file. So that's a 10-15 minute electronic video final submission. Not for every matter, but supposing there's a final hearing matter and you want to file written submission, you can request the judge, can I give you an audio video electronic submission? So you record a video for a short 5, 10, 15 minutes, whatever is required, and forward it to the court. Now that will help a great deal rather than just written submissions. Now to further expand the sphere of hearing of matters during the period of suspended functioning, Delhi High Court has decided to take up certain categories of already pending matters which are ripe for final hearing. But that is with the consent of parties. Till now, only urgent matters are being listed. Now you can even request, if your case falls into that category, for your matter to be taken up if pleadings are complete. It's ready for final hearing. Please request. And all you need to do is give a joint consent on this link and a time slot will be allocated. So the matters, the categories which are presently allocated are protection of women for direct domestic violence, matrimonial eviction matters, criminal appeals where convicts are in custody, MACT appeals, petitions under Section 9, Section 34, quashing of criminal cases, and ex parte matters. So if your case falls in this category, both parties agree and pleadings are complete, just give a request and the matter will be taken up for final hearing in next few days. So we don't have to wait for the normal functioning to resume. Now work in progress, when you want to argue a matter, one thing that will be required will be digital copies of the court file. So that's work in progress. Maybe very soon we'll be able to provide you with digital copies of the court files, or you can access it, then you will have a file which will duplicate, will be a replica copy of the judge's file. Now, this is what I said as late as it is mid-2019. What next? Online filing? We have online filing now. Virtual courtrooms? We have virtual courtrooms. Arguments, video conferencing? We already have it. Now, question is, what next now? Artificial intelligence. Well, can AI help improve access to court? Artificial intelligence can address the fundamental issues arising in legal system. Analyze the quality of a legal claim and evidence. Now, question is, will it replace judges? No, artificial intelligence will not replace judges, but it will provide legal reasoning to a litigant to understand if his case is in accordance with law or not. It can help litigants know their rights and claims and even make a more informed decision whether he should litigate at all or not, or maybe settle the matter. So this is, again, maybe near future, maybe COVID-19 takes a twist. So Steve Jobs had said, people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who actually do. Thank you. That's all I have in my presentation. Now, over to Nitesh and the other panelists if there are some other questions.
Yeah, may I now request Ravi sir to take over. Ravi sir.
Thank you so much, Honorable Justice Sadeva sir. It's been such an informative and an insightful lecture. Sitting at homes, we are able to actually get the access of post-COVID the courts would look like. We are very grateful to your lordships, and we would request your lordship to address the questions of the audience from here on. We are very grateful to your lordships. It's been an extreme insightful lecture, and it's full of information. We have been able to gather what is going to be post-COVID, the virtual courts. Very grateful to your lordships, and we would request your lordships to address the audience's questions.
I think before we go into questions, probably Ms. Ingorani would like to share something about what the Supreme Court is, because I have primarily covered some briefly on the Delhi High Court. Ms. Ingorani and Aristotle, who are joining us from the Supreme Court, they would like to give us an insight into what they think about the present position and the way forward.
As your lordship says. Ma'am, would I request you to please take over from here, ma'am?
Ma'am, you are not audible.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Ma'am, yes, you have to repeat again. You were not audible. Now it's audible, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Justice Sachdeva. That was really informative. The way we are to go forward now and what is actually happening in the Delhi High Court and all the subordinate courts. I had a few questions which I thought I'll ask later once we have all our other panelists who have made their comments. Well, we have been facing a lot of questions, a lot of difficulties since the lockdown. And we are trying to see how the courts system has started evolving itself for the members of the bar. The difficulties the bar is facing is very acute at the moment. And I think the biggest problem that the members, whether it is at the Supreme Court or in all the other courts across the country, is that we do not have proper infrastructure in place. This has taken us by surprise. COVID-19 has come at a time where the infrastructure in the courts was not developed as it should have been. The lawyers do not have the appropriate training which is required. And I think the need of the hour, the urgency at the moment, is for the bar councils, the bar associations to take the assistance of the court system management and start immediate training for the lawyers and the court clerks because everybody is at a loss, and the legal profession itself is at stake, because once the courts are locked down, the infrastructure not being there, the lawyers not being prepared, there is no disposal. Since there's no disposal at the district court level, there are no matters before the high court. Similarly, since there's no disposal at the high courts, there are no matters in the Supreme Court. We have been watching over the last month and a half that mostly COVID-related matters have been coming up in courts, and only very urgent matters have been listed for the courts, since the courts are in the process of preparing for virtual courts. My suggestion, and I have been in touch with most of our colleagues from the Supreme Court and the High Court, is that while the virtual court systems are being put in place, there is something which needs to be urgently done. And I'm sure Joseph will support me in this. And Aman has also experienced this while he's been doing some matters. That in the court premises, whether it is Delhi High Court at the or the Supreme Court, we have enough space where we can set up a temporary infrastructure of computers, of social distancing rooms, where lawyers who do not have the support system either at their residences or in their offices are able to come there and carry on with their work. I think the need of the hour is that, and I hope we are able to take this forward. With this, I think we'll ask, I'll request Tarun to take over and take the proceedings along and put the opening remarks, and Joseph and Aman can share their thoughts, and then Tarun can take over. Thank you. Tarun, would you like to take over? Nitish, can you unmute Tarun and the other panelists?
I'll just see.
Yes, now I'm audible, I guess.
Yes, Tarun.
I would like to thank Justice Sachdeva and Senior Advocate Priya Hingunari for sharing their views. Now we would like to go to Aman Sareen to see if he has to make a point, and then we can move forward for the questions. Aman, would you like to make some points on today's issue?
Tarun, Aman and Joseph as well.
Joseph, yes. Both of them, Aman and Joseph, both. Back to back. Joseph, would you like to come in first?
Can you unmute him?
Ma'am, I've already did. I think they need to do it from their part.
Yeah. Hi. I'm. Guess I'm audible.
Yes, Joseph, you are audible.
Yes, Joseph, my question was, would you like to make an intervention, make your points on today's issue, and also raise any questions that you might have?
Yes, I would just like to add on the status of Supreme Court at present, probably within a minute. And first of all, I would at the outset thank all of you for this opportunity this evening and this program. You know, it's I can say a program at the right time with the right information. And I also thank Justice Sachdev for such a, I can say, a 3D flow, you know, with this demonstration of video. We now know how to do it in the Delhi High Court. Well, from the Supreme Court, I would just like to put in a gist that what we learned from this pandemic is actually a very demonstrative fact that we were actually equipped to handle it. We were equipped, but this was an opportunity that we demonstrated it. On March 23rd, if I recollect, was the last Court of Congregation held in the Supreme Court. And immediately by 25th, we had the first video conferencing court. And by 26th, we had the SOPs. And subsequently, very broadly speaking, we just had from the Supreme Court about 2 to 3 conditions. One was relaxations, that you could file it online and the affidavit need not be affirmed. That was the first thing we did for social distancing. There need not be a client who needs to travel for the wakalat or the affidavit. And even the stamp fee need not be paid at that time. Just a simple undertaking would suffice. And subsequent to that, the consent of both the parties is something we emphasized when it had to be taken in a video conference. And as well to answer Priya ma'am's query, the Supreme Court did have a place. And even now we have a premise where a client or a lawyer can attend. It was opened by 23rd March. We had notified it. But subsequently by 15th April, if I'm not wrong, after 15th April, after the lockdown, when it became more severe, we requested them to avoid using the premises. We requested them. And to put it in a nutshell, because we don't have much time, we also have the suo moto proceeding that was taken by Supreme Court in suo moto proceeding writ petition number 5, wherein the guidelines have been laid down, a very broad guidelines have been laid down in what procedure we have to do the virtual courts. We have the e-committee led by Justice Dr. Chandrachud, who is very accommodative. And now the Supreme Court, after continuous efforts from this Quora as well, we are now going to have a 24/7 facility. And I think very unprecedentedly, the Supreme Court is going to host a webinar. The Supreme Court themselves will be hosting a webinar on this Friday at 4 o'clock. And Justice Chandrachud has led the complete e-committee, and there are more than 11 software professionals working in it. They want to make it more user-friendly as possible, more accessible, and more reliable in a lesser bandwidth. We have so many other things, but I think I would conclude with this.
Thank you so much, Joseph, for making your points and sharing the points that you shared with us. I would like to go to Aman Sareen at this point and request him to make a point which he wanted to.
First of all, I would like to thank Justice Ajdeva for such a useful webinar and such a useful things we have learned today from my lords. And I have not faced personally not a problem through VC before the courts and all. But we have so many our friends on this webinar. They are keen to ask some questions because I am receiving some messages. So I request Nitesh to take over all these questions. Then we'll be able to answer them.
Yes, Nitesh, could you please take over and ask a few questions?
In the meantime, I request Robby sir, if you want to speak up something with regard to the lecture of Sanjeev Sajdeva sir. Robby sir.
Thank you, Nitesh. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yes, you are audible.
I would like to thank Justice Sajdeva sir for such a wonderful insight. And I would just like to add on to Priya Hingorani ma'am, I believe yesterday there was a meeting between the law minister and attorney general and other law officers where the secretary justice was also present. And I believe everybody was being encouraged that we should have e-court system more accessible to the lawyers and especially the young lawyers. And I believe the Secretary Justice, who's also the member of the e-court committee of Supreme Court, was asked to bring the challenges, these challenges before the committee and in coordination with NIC and other agencies to improve the system. I believe that the Secretary, the Secretary Department of Justice shared that there has been a significant growth in the number of advocates who have registered for e-filing of cases. He informed 1,282 advocates have registered e-filing of the petitions during the lockdown, out of which 554 advocates have registered just in last 1 week. So therefore the moot point being over here that the coming years are now totally going to be of virtual courts. And I believe and I really think that our bar associations and the bar council should do something for training the young lawyers.
Thank you, Robby sir. We have our viewer, Nidhi Bidra. Nidhi, yes, if you want to ask the question, you are unmute now. You can ask the question from the panelists.
Yes, good evening. My question is to Honorable Justice Sanjeev Sajdeva. Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
So, a few days back, Justice Deepak Gupta retired from Supreme Court, and he made a very good statement that sit in courtrooms and not bar rooms to learn craft from your seniors. Now, I wanted an insight from you. But do you think this depersonalized approach will be able to strike a balance between the actual learning, which happens only in courts, because especially for interns and junior advocates, because you learn a lot when you see the demeanor of the judges, when they are interacting with the parties, a lot of learning is there. So I wanted your insight on that aspect of depersonalized approach. How will that be handled in virtual courts?
See, with the change of scenario, I guess you have to change yourself also.
Yeah,
watching the virtual courts, watching the findings, watching the arguments going on in courts through net is the answer for it right now. I understand that being present physically in a court was a different aspect altogether. But that's what, as Honorable Justice Sadeva sir has said, that the courts... to address the issue. I would request you to ask this question to Justice Sadeva sir.
Yes. Sir is not audible. Justice Sadeva is not audible.
His mic is switched off, I guess.
Sir has to do it.
Yes, Nidhi. First and foremost, you see, what you have asked is a very important question. Now, all court hearings have to be public hearings. Now, the problem we have in a VC is what you see just now. Someone's sharing his screen right now, but who goes by the name of, I don't know, Babaji. Well, Babaji is requested, please stop sharing your screen. Now, this is the kind of discipline which has to be maintained in a court hearing. Nitesh, can you please take care of the screen?
I just take him off, sir. I think he's not tech cube, so that's why he's not able to do it now.
Now, Nidhi, what happens is, if you would have read the newspaper a few days back, there was an open hearing being conducted in one of the high courts, and I think 67 odd people joined in that hearing, and they started disturbing the proceedings, and the proceedings couldn't go on. So unless we discipline ourselves, this will not be possible. Though we are working on sort of an open court system where anybody can join in, view the proceedings, but the discipline has to start from within. Till that happens, we'll be a little way away from probably having open hearings. But maybe in time to come, things will be much better. Now, coming back to what Priya had said with regard to preparation of lawyers, etc., now, you see, the problem today is that technically we are ready, but we don't have enough infrastructure. Now, in the sense, hardware is not available because of the lockdown. So once the lockdown opens, all courts will be in a position to acquire hardware and then utilize that for providing e-court facilities to all. And in Delhi High Court, we have created two courtrooms where the lawyers can come in and use them as a virtual courtroom. Rather, if they, in case they don't have their own infrastructure, they can come into court and use those courtrooms and then argue from there. So we maintain social distancing. We have provided equipment. The two courtrooms have been made available. And Nitesh, please take care of this screen sharing.
Sir, I am looking after him, sir. I'm looking after him, sir.
Thank you, sir. Certainly, yes. The challenge is huge, especially for district courts, because we have 672 district courts in India, in which almost around 2.3 criminal cases are presently pending. So, yes, we have to work. Everyone has to work cumulatively towards.
You see, it is not only infrastructure. We are also looking at connectivity.
Yes, sir.
Now, some of the district courts in the country are facing power problem. The government is working substantially on it. They are looking at providing infrastructure. Computers have been provided to every district court. They are resolving the issue with regard to electricity. Now connectivity is another issue that the government is working on, and I'm sure with the proactive government that we have, very soon we'll be able to have all the courts functioning online.
Okay, sir.
Now, there is a question I see on the screen from one Mr. Vikram Grover as to what is the kind of memory limitation in document case file. Well, some courts have set a limit of 25 MB or 50 MB. So it is all court specific. Now, if you want to file, like Supreme Court has said that it's 25 MB, and if you want to file a higher document, file it in different folders. Rather, instead of one filing, you file it three times, then you'll have 75 MB. Now, in Delhi High Court, you can go into a location, the designated location, and file an unlimited capacity document.
Sir, there is a question by one of our viewers who is saying, sir, what is the way out of the regular hearings if that can also be carried out by the virtual hearing that's been done in the COVID times? Sir, question to Sandeep, sir.
That's exactly what I had said in my presentation, that non-urgent matters can be taken up for hearing with consent of parties. At the moment, certain categories have been created. If your case does not fall in that category, the categories will be expanded, or you could make a request to the court. If your request is allowed, then that matter can be taken up for urgent hearing. So very soon we'll have non-urgent matters being taken up for hearing on regular days, because the courts are not shut. These are not vacations. We are all functioning. Now, every day, most of the judges are sitting. So courts are functioning. So if you want to file your matters, please go ahead and file them. Urgent matters, extremely urgent matters, non-urgent matters, nothing stopping the lawyers from filing your briefs. Please file them.
So we have one participant, Supriya. You are now unmuted. You can ask your question. Supriya Arora.
Hello. Good evening, everyone. I just need to ask, how can we certain the acknowledgement of the documents by the opposite counsel through email? Because there is no such any system like WhatsApp that we get the double ticks that someone has acknowledged our message. So how can we do that from email?
Ms. Arora, even in WhatsApp, there are features available where you can ensure that that blue double tick doesn't go back. So
yes, sir.
There are technical systems available, but that's not part of this presentation. But that will be a highly technical session as to how you can have a confirmed record of an email being delivered. Now, you'll do it through the IP addresses, but that's a long-drawn process. Maybe we'll have to do it in some other session. But yes, there are systems in place whereby one can confirm that an email has been delivered. But again, that's a long-drawn process, and that will be something maybe for a different forum and a different session.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, we have, sir, another question which has been popped up. Sir, is it necessary to have a digital signature on an e-filing, or a signature by the e-pen can be sufficient to file it?
At the moment, it is not mandatory to have your digital signatures, but because relaxation has been provided, otherwise digital signature is a must. Now, for our income tax filing, you need a digital signature. So most of the people have taken digital signatures. You can have digital signatures, and it's not a very longish process to obtain one. So it's better that once the lockdown opens, please obtain a digital signature. It'll be easier for you. You can sign it physically and then scan it and upload it. But then as a counsel, you're giving a certificate that yes, it is signed by your client and by your party. Yes, Nitesh, anything else?
Any other question by the viewers or the participants, they can just chat to us, or...
I think Mr. Narang has been wanting to ask something.
Yes, sir. Mr. Narang, sir, is looking for asking for that there are poor Wi-Fi networks in the High Court, and what more efforts have to be put in to rectify the said position?
Sorry?
He has asked that there are poor Wi-Fi networks in our own High Court, and what more efforts have been put in to rectify the said problem?
No, poor networks as in where?
The Wi-Fi networks he's talking about, sir.
You see, we have been chasing the vendor who's been providing the open Wi-Fi to the lawyers. Now, but that is now controlled by the Bar Association. So, and even otherwise, you don't need these Wi-Fi networks, your cell phones and mobile devices have this 4G connectivity, which is very good. But if you need a Wi-Fi connection, you'll have to chase the Bar Association. From the High Court's point of view, we've given free hand to the Bar Association. Bring in a vendor, they'll be able to provide you with a Wi-Fi network. Ms. Hingurani probably has a question or a comment. Nitesh, Ms. Hingurani's mic.
I just see, sir. So, Darshan Kaushik, I think, Ms. Kaushik, you are now unmuted, so you can ask your question.
Hello, good evening, everyone. Sir, my question is India ready to embrace virtual courts hearings without any coded law for protecting evidences, confidentiality, and maintaining decorum of the courts? Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible, but yeah. What is your question?
Sir, my question is related to cybersecurity. Is India ready to embrace virtual courts hearing without any coded law? Like we have seen in last few years, like countries like Canada and USA, they are also facing cyber issues, hacking issues in virtual hearings and all. So is India ready to deal with all those challenges?
Well, India is pioneer in sort of dealing with these challenges. Indian software designers go across the world and provide them with these software solutions. Now, all of our hearings are secure. We go through this link. And they're all through a secure network. Nobody can actually snoop in or join in that hearing. But yes, this cyber crime is a challenge. So yeah. The cyber experts will have to keep at it. Now, as lawyers, my advice would be, please have a very good antivirus and anti-malware system in your computers. Because most of the lawyers try to go for the free version. Yes. Go for one of the paid versions. If you are secure, you will ensure that the High Court and the court proceedings are secure. But if you file in proceedings which contain a virus, then it will cause a problem. So you have to, as individuals, also bring in systems into your own place, secure your systems so that our system is secure.
And sir,
what
about tampering of evidences and all? Like, no, is evidence, it possible?
Evidence can't be tampered, because once something goes into the High Court server, that file doesn't come out.
Okay, sir.
For example, if a file is sent to a judge for arguing for a matter, the original file remains in the server.
Okay, sir.
Now, that can never be tampered. It's all password protected and there are logs created. If anybody accesses that file, it's through a log.
Okay, sir.
So nobody can go and destroy or damage a file which is in the court server.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Aditya Chaudhary, you are now unmuted. If you have the question, you can ask.
Yeah. Am I audible, please?
Yes, Aditya.
Good evening, sir. I'm Aditya Chaudhary, advocate here. My question to my Lord Justice Sachdeva. In the system of virtual hearing, how do we train the young lawyers? If any young lawyer whose matter is not listed wants to come to court or wants to watch the proceedings, how does he do so? Because as far as I understand, this system works that whose matters are listed can only get a password, and they are the ones who can actually participate in the hearings, and after the matter is over, they are disconnected. So what happens to a young lawyer who wants to hear somebody argue or wants to know something about the court?
Mr. Chaudhary, at the moment, we are working on system whereby we can have open hearings. But because of limitation in terms of people who can connect for a particular hearing and the discipline not being followed by some persons, it becomes very difficult to make it an open hearing. We can very easily share the meeting ID and password with anybody who wants to join in. So what happens if 100 people join in and you as a counsel want to argue and someone keeps his mic on or starts sharing presentations? You will get disturbed. So the host has to be then very vigilant in terms of sort of muting everybody, expelling people who are disturbing. Because like I just mentioning to Ms. Nidhi, that in one of the high courts, this problem was faced. 67 people joined in, there was cross-talking, then they kept disturbing the proceedings and the proceedings didn't continue. So once we learn to discipline ourselves in terms of just watching and not participating, then I'm sure we can have open hearings. It's not difficult to have an open hearing. You could have, we are also looking at open hearing because it sort of reduces the footfall. If your client sitting at his house can watch the court proceedings, then why will he actually travel to court? He will just log on and see what his lawyer has done, what arguments have taken place, what order is passed at his own residence. So we are also looking at those systems. But let's see if we can develop some very soon.
Grateful, Milas.
Sir, Pawan Narang again this side. I just want one query is to be cleared. Like, if somebody wants to intervene in a matter, now he doesn't know what the time slot has been given to the petition or that matter to be taken up. So what would be the procedure if somebody wants to intervene?
Mr. Narang, if you look at the cause list which comes in there, because cause list is still being displayed, that will give the contact details of the courtmaster of that court. So you can send in a request to the courtmaster that I want to intervene. If you have an application, send that application to the courtmaster over the link that is provided, and you'll be sent a link and you'll join in. We've had instances where parties have joined in, like during a hearing, one person said, I want my brother to join in. So immediately the courtmaster sent a link and his brother joined in those proceedings and the matter continued. So rather on a virtual court, it's far easier than a physical court for him to enter into and join in the proceedings.
Thank you very much, sir. But there's another aspect, just a question otherwise also. What is the timeline we are looking for the normal working hours to come back?
That I can't tell you, because we'll have to wait for the Prime Minister to make an announcement on the 17th and then probably let's see. But we're all lawyers and judges are eager to get back. That's one thing for sure.
And person like us who are staying in either Noida or Gurgaon, it's becoming a very difficult. We can't even approach our offices. Go to our offices.
So go virtual. Go virtual.
Files are lying in office. Books are lying in the office. You only have a makeshift office at the residence. So those are the difficulties.
I have a question. I think Nitish, Amit Khemkaji had a question to ask.
Yeah, I just asked him to be animated. Sir, in the meantime, there is one participant of us, that's Mr. Abhimanyu Chopra. He has asked a question about the future prospects of the VC on the point of cross-examination, exhibition of documents, if they could also be a part in the later part of the virtual courts.
Yes, certainly. We are also looking at evidence being recorded over VC, because you can project documents, you can show them on the screen, and even digitally mark a document. It's not started, but very soon probably that will also start. Because if court has to function over VC, then every aspect of the court has to be functional over VC. Because at that point, then you'll have to provide enough infrastructure to the witness to actually see the document, to be able to converse with his lawyer. Because litigant may want to converse with his lawyer at the time when the lawyer is cross-examining the opposite side. Now that kind of place, system has to be put in place before you can start actual evidence being recorded over VC. But we are working on it, and soon probably that will also happen.
May I now request Amit Khemkaji? You are also unmuted. You can ask your question to his lordships.
Sir, first of all, let me thank you and congratulate you for being very, very proactive and progressive. You know, I'm really proud to be part of such an institution which has been so quick in adapting to the situation and fighting with it. So my heartfelt thank you to you and to everyone who is working to make it happen. Sir, the problem is that right now the petitions which we have to file and upload, they are unsigned. They are not signed by the client. Now, signing by the client actually acts not only he has to swear that, but also it acts as a shield for us. Tomorrow the client cannot say that, sorry, I did not want to say this or I did not want to write this. So is it not a good idea that a video message from the petitioner or the party is also uploaded along with the petition in a form verifying that the petition has his consent. Now, something like that could right now, because we can't have affidavits right now. So, can't we have something like a video message from him?
Mr. Khemka, the exemption at the moment is from filing the physical document in court.
Okay.
So you have to, and maybe attestation because the oath commissioner is not available. Yes. But the requirement doesn't say that you will not even have it signed from your client. If your client comes to you for a meeting, or if he is conversing with you over the net, for example, he sends you an email, then if you send him an email of the document and he confirms back, yes, this document is acceptable, please file it. That should be a safeguard for the lawyer. But it can't be that you have nothing in your records and he orally gives you instructions and you orally file a petition. Then, of course, tomorrow there can be a difficulty.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea that we send a mail and ask him for confirmation.
And in some of the hearings that we had, we've had officers send email rather than a status report. For example, if a status report was to be filed in a court, the officers were asked to, from their official email address, send an email to the designated link, which was then treated as the status report.
That's great, sir. Thank
you. So you will have to be proactive and probably develop certain safeguards for the lawyers also.
Yes.
Balod, I would like to add in Mr. Khemka's question one more thing regarding the Vakalatnama, because when we filed a regular bail application, so we need that Vakalatnama also along with the application. So, my lord, the same thing can be asked from the client regarding that.
And attested from jail.
Yes, because the jail authorities these days due to lockdown is not doing anything and many of these applications are still is to be filed. So, this is also one of the things.
Well, that can be looked at as to how that will happen. But right now, they're filing written documents in the form of a Vakalatnama where they call client sort of writes it and authorizes it. You can have your template of a Vakalatnama sent, which he confirms over the email and sends it back. From jail, again, jail superintendent will have to step in because bail orders are being passed where bail bonds are being furnished to the satisfaction of the jail superintendent.
Yes, Manoj, yes.
So the jails are...
Regarding that, Parokar can also sign the document.
Yes, Parokar for a criminal matter. In any case, a Parokar can always sign that. He can sign a Vakalatnama.
I have a question, Justice Sachdeva. My concern is, again, for the members of the bar, the young members of the bar who are facing a lot of problem in getting their matters listed or having a place where they can come in get their petitions typed and scanned and filed. Supreme Court, as Joseph mentioned, they did put a designated place, but it is not working at the moment. Is there is a designated space which has been allotted in the High Court, and is there any training or thought process in from the bar as well as from with the help of the Delhi High Court, training of lawyers in this situation and which is the need of the hour at the moment?
You see, in the High Court, two courtrooms, I think courtroom number 17 and 24, have been provided as two courtrooms where the VC system have been set up and lawyers can come in. And if they don't have a VC system at their place, they can come into court in those two courtrooms. Then following social distancing, they can argue their matter. Insofar as scanning is and digitization is concerned, in each of the district courts and the High Court, the digitization center is working. And during the period of lockdown, it's been free. It's made free. So just take in your petition, they'll scan it for you for free. Otherwise, infrastructure is there. Once the lockdown opens and before the lockdown started, you could bring your petition in, pay the requisite fee with nominal charges, even less than a photocopy of a page. And the person will digitize your file and give it to you on a pen drive.
Thank you.
So there is one more question by one of our viewers, Rishabh Jain. I know that's not related to today's topic, but since most of the young lawyers are watching this webinar, his question is that what is your message to the young lawyers in the period of this pandemic?
You see, my answer to them is we look at these young lawyers because they are our teachers. They are far more proactive in terms of technology than most of us. So why don't they come up with suggestions and tell us how do we take it forward? You apply your mind. You're very techno savvy. You're aware of these softwares and other systems in place. As young law students or young lawyers, come up with ideas, shoot them to us. Maybe we'll be able to pick up something and give you a system which is very, very user-friendly for all of us.
Yes, we have Jugal sir with us. Mr. Jugal Wadhwa, advocate. Sir, you can definitely ask a question. You are now unmuted, sir. Please, go ahead, sir.
Good evening to everybody. My question is specific to district courts. See, as everybody knows that we have very small and cramped courtrooms over there. And specifically when it comes to like cross-examining the witness or addressing the court, the distance between the witness and the counsel as well as the court, that is very, very small, very, very marginal. So do we have any special plans, sir, for the district courts, how to like have access to open hearings in the district courts, especially places like the Sazari? And especially also when we have to walk in the corridors, we have to jostle and we have to pass across tens of people in order to reach a particular place. So do we have any special plans for district courts also, especially a place like the Sazari, in order to start open courts?
Mr. Wadhwa, the Chief Justice of Delhi High Court has nominated a special committee to look into the functioning of the district court. And that committee is looking into it. The problems that you have highlighted are actually the problems which have prevented us from opening up the district courts for public at the moment. Right. Because knowing the footfall, probably the footfall in district courts is far greater than the footfall anywhere else, except barring the railway station and the ISBTs. That's the highest footfall we have in the district court. So we are also looking at systems whereby we can have open hearings so that litigant doesn't need to come to court to view his case and he can view it. Maybe live streaming could be one option, but all these are options which the committee is exploring. If you have live streaming of the court proceedings going on, then anybody can watch them from any place.
That may not be a practical solution as far as the MMs and civil judges courts are concerned. Because they are very small courts, there are hardly any space for the lawyers even to sit in the courts. There are hardly any working space in the
courts open up.
My one suggestion would be, sir.
Yes.
Then we have to take a reconstruction kind of a thing, a renovation kind of a thing. And so as far as the courts, specifically the cases are concerned, we have to expand the courts. We have to make bigger areas available to the judges as well as the lawyers. So maybe some kind of activity would be required. So we need some time to accomplish that kind of a task at this juncture. So the things will have to be put in place or well in time for that purpose.
Mr. Wadhwa, that means providing fresh infrastructure, which may take some time, but we are looking at immediately opening the court so that litigants who've been waiting for their matters can start. So probably we'll have to do it with social distancing and lesser footfall in court for the moment.
Yeah.
Joseph?
Justice Sachdev, sir.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir. So I was just, it was just a suggestion and in addition to one of the queries, that if, for instance, if the parties give their consent and if the advocates are prepared to argue a matter or present a matter, would it be viable for the registry to mail the PDF format of the file and enable them to argue it? Because in this time, there is the main problems that many of them are facing is access to their files, but to the physical files. Some of them offers have it in the cloud. We have it in Dropbox and other softwares. But for in Supreme Court, we are talking about, now we are listing single judge matters like with regard to bail, transfer petitions, etc. If both the parties concerned and if the advocates are also prepared, then would the registry be able to provide them with a PDF copy of the file and give them some time to prepare?
We are working on that. and very soon, our aim is to provide you with that file, and probably very soon you should be able to get it, because we're working on it at the moment.
Thank
you. To make the file available, that you send a link, you send an email, and you have the file over email available to you, or maybe downloadable from the High Court website.
Thank you, sir. It was just a suggestion. Thank you, sir.
That we are looking, that we are already working on.
Thank you, sir.
Lots, I have a question, if your lordship allows me, Lots.
Yes, Mr. Goman.
Lots, for family courts, where mutual consent is Lots, agreed upon between the parties, and if one of the person is abroad, Lots, I believe this concept would be very good. Rather than him coming over here and being present physically, the virtual court would be a very nice initiative.
Yes, that is one area where it can be put to good use. Even mediation. Even in mediation, we are looking at joining parties over VC rather than making them travel to court.
Correct. Grateful.
I think
one more question.
Yes.
Is there any plan to, in order to reduce the number of people accessing the High Court, is there any plan to review the policy for the interns? Because you know that every lawyer is having large number of interns these days accompanying. Is there any policy being framed for the entry of the interns in the High Court?
At the moment, because of the lockdown and just before the lockdown, interns were not permitted in the High Court. But Mr. Padma, we have to train these youngsters into becoming good lawyers, and unless they come into court, how are they going to learn?
That's right. But can we put?
So we have to balance both sides.
Yeah, we have to balance both the sides.
Let's see what the committee decides on that.
Yeah, we cannot take away that opportunity and privilege from.
Yes.
Maybe the number can be curbed or something, like hours can be divided. A lawyer can call
maybe an odd even
in pre-lunch session.
If you have
turns in post,
if you have an odd name or if you have an even name, you come on a different day.
Yes, we have not done a good thing to deprive them from the cafeteria already. But something can be done in that regard also, because
yes, the committee is in fact looking into it also.
Yeah.
Thank you. I think so.
Absolutely, ma'am. Nitish, if all the questions are over, should we thank Justice Sadeva, sir?
Almost all the questions have been taken up, and we have taken separately also. There is one, Arinder Singh, if he wants to ask one question.
Nitish, you can put that question and...
He has not given me the question. Harinder, yes, you can put in. You are now unmuted. You can put that question.
Good afternoon to all of you. My question is to HMJS Sanjay Sadeva. Sir, how effective can be like process of cross-examination can be put in place in the district courts via this VC thing? How can we like deal with that?
Mr. Singh, cross-examination, certainly we are looking at putting it into place, but it will take some time because witnesses have to be comfortable, lawyers have to be comfortable. So it will take some time for cross-examination to, a full-fledged cross-examination to start over VC. But yes, time will tell, and it may not be too far off, because even this virtual court seemed a thing of the distance, when in few months and rather days we've had to actually adopt virtual courts. So maybe cross-examination also will be able to start soon, but it will take some time, because for that you'll have to have the witnesses equipped, the lawyers equipped, the litigants equipped. So that yes. Infrastructure has to be put into place before we get into full-fledged cross-examination.
Yes, sir. One more thing, sir. What would be the words of wisdom to the young lawyers from your side?
I've already said, you guide us. Be at it. And watch these webinars. There are several webinars happening. Spend your time wisely. There are a lot of webinars happening on legal issues. Please watch them. And if you have any, if anybody has any further questions, please share it with Mr. Nitesh, the host, and I'll answer that through him, and he'll send it, send the response back to you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Nitesh, can we thank Justice Sadeva, sir?
Yes, Robby, sir. I think from here, you can conclude the lecture.
Yeah, I'll be grateful. Sir. Am I audible?
Chandar,
yes, you are audible.
Mr. Chandar Lal has entered.
Malots, thank you so very much for this very insightful and educative lecture. It's been an honor, and we all are very thankful for, to you for sparing your valuable time and giving such an insightful lecture. And we will be requesting and looking forward for another such lecture from your end, Malots. Thank you
thank
so
you very much.
Much.
It will be a pleasure. Thanks.
Obliged, Malots. Greatly obliged.
Thank you, all of you. We have provided with the email. If anybody has left with any question, they can drop in the email. And we'll put it across and we'll get the answers back from Justice Vasudeva.
And thank I will send my PowerPoint presentation to Mr. Mehra and he'll place it on the link, whatever.
Thank you so much, sir. We'll do it thank in the group, sir. Okay. Yeah, thank you from the Lecture Series on Law group. Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful time.
Thank you, everyone. And thank you for your time. And we'll hope to see you again soon. Thank you, Tarun and Nitesh and Robby and Joseph. We'll see you again soon.
Good evening, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody.